Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Table Talk with Brenda Perryman, right here on TV 33 WHPR. And we have an exciting show for you today. And before I get started, let me introduce my co-hosts, or let them introduce themselves.
Good morning. My name is Cheryl Ajimu. I'm owner of the Ajimu Group. We produce the Multicultural Media Luncheon during the Detroit Auto Show.
Good morning, Tamika Ashford, president of the Ashford Agency, a boutique PR firm.
Dr. Rose Moulton, clinical psychologist and author of Bloom, Seven Steps to Personal Transformation.
Now, this is a very, very interesting show that we're having today, but I'm going to do On This Day by Mr. Ken Coleman, which is one of our co-hosts sometimes when he's not busy, but he's a wonderful gentleman, and he wrote On This Day, October 10th. In 1929, Elijah McCoy joins the ancestors. The local resident was 85 years old. He was the inventor, known for more than 57 U.S. patents, most of them involving the steam or stream engine. McCoy, who had an African ancestry, was born a free man in 1844 in Ontario, Canada. Isn't that something? That Canada is. Had free men.
Well, that's why they headed north.
I know.
You've never been to the Wilds Museum over there?
No.
Have you heard of it?
No.
It's in Canada, and it was based, well, it's, I don't know if you remember the story about a couple that, there was a book or a movie done about them. They left the U.S., went to Canada, and there is a museum there, and you can like go through a forest like you're going through, you know, going from the north to the south. Uh-huh. It's called the Walls Family Museum.
Is it in Windsor?
I think it's in Windsor.
Okay. Oh,
I think
it's outside of Windsor.
Oh, that would be
it. Toronto. I'm not sure, but it's
that
a
would
very
be
interesting.
A wonderful family trip.
Yeah.
Speaking of trips, today a new movie is coming out called Addicted, and a lot of, and it's from a book by Zane. And a lot of people are looking forward to seeing it, Dr. Rose Moulton.
Oh, yes.
And we have a guest here this morning who is going to talk about the film. And I think we have a free pass.
Ooh,
so we will be back in just a moment.
Do we qualify for that?
I don't know. We'll be back in just a moment. Oh, we are back. We are back with Table Talk with Brenda Perryman. Good morning again. And that's exciting. I think somebody's on the phone who's calling in for the tickets. Sorry, ladies.
Oh, well.
Okay. National news. We're going to go through this kind of quickly. We got quite a, a long group of things to talk about. Plus, we're going to talk a little at the end with Kim Cattrall from Sex in the City about menopause. I waited till the ladies were on. So
you should have scared the men. See how uncomfortable, hot under the collar they get.
Well, you know, the Ebola patient, Mr. Duncan, he died this week.
Yeah.
And people are saying, well, he should have gotten the same thing the others gotten, you know, the antibodies and everything, but they said it was just too late. He was too far gone. Mm-hmm. Also, I was talking with a doctor this morning. You know, you get up to the minute stuff that said that he took some Tylenol and some other things prior to
help his symptoms. Lower his fever.
Yeah, and everything to help him get in the country.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, well, reading the story, it also says when that it was checked, no, have you been in any contact with someone with Ebola? And he picked up the woman who was actively, you know, in the very serious, you know, body fluids coming out of her mouth, blood stages, pregnant woman to carry her in the house. So that was direct exposure right there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but I'm sure we're going to hear more about the story. Before I heard that part, I was really upset with the hospital in Dallas, and I'm still upset with the lack of just urgency that they took his case. Yeah. When he went there originally, they sent him home. He was home for a few days, and we all know from what we're learning from the news shows, the quicker that the virus is treated, the better the prognosis. Right. So there were very critical days in which the virus just really, you know, ravished and took over his body that he could possibly be alive. With all that said, it also sounds like he wasn't necessarily forthcoming, if the stories are true, about his exposure prior to coming in the country, and that puts other people at risk.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, the doctor that I spoke to this morning said that, wouldn't you want to get over here?
They were discussing that on the radio this morning. Someone was saying, you know, if I have Ebola in the country, I'm going to come over to the U.S. because at least I know I'll get treatment and I'll lie about it. And, you know, it's just like, okay, please don't start that trend going. And which is why the airports are going to definitely have to beef up screening.
More vigilant.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're going to have to be more vigilant. It's just a shame because they said they kept him 4 hours. And for that 4 hours, though, maybe they weren't thinking to look for Ebola. I don't know. It seems like they should have found something. I think there was negligence.
Yeah, he did tell them he had just come from, you know, the region in Africa where it's really ravishing that region. So the hospital admits to that. And they said the hospital personnel dropped the ball, you know, in that instance, by not notifying, I guess, individuals that this guy was from this region, because he should have not ever left that hospital there. So it's really unfortunate. But one of the things, if you want to look at, I guess, if you can say there's a bright side, we are not as, I think, as speedily as we need to, but becoming more educated about the virus. But there's still a lot of misconceptions out there that has people just in panic and an uproar.
Absolutely. You know, I was talking to a doctor, and he was saying that now we have an article that says the panic is worse than the disease. And panic can be. It could lead to a paranoia about
absolutely.
Other people, about touching people, about everything. No contact.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It seems as if there should be some type of education, some type of PSAs to go out to educate the public, because a lot of people are still not aware as to what is Ebola. Mm-hmm. I mean, what is it? And so I've read a couple of definitions. I still feel like I don't have a real clear definition as to what this virus is.
Or how it's transmitted.
Absolutely.
Well, what we do know is that it has to be transmitted through bodily fluids. People are equating this, and I'm equating it not necessarily the disease, but the confusion and the just pandemonium that's going on with it now to the AIDS epidemic of the early 80s, where people really didn't know. You remember when kids weren't allowed to go to school if they had it, and, you know, people were just ostracized.
Yes.
You can't get Ebola from a sneeze. You know, there was a story this morning.
Yes, I saw that.
You saw that the United Airlines on its way to Dominican Republic, and one of the passengers sneezes and jokingly says, I have Ebola.
Yeah, I saw that.
They grounded the plane, hazmat suits are on. I mean, and you understand, again, it's a lack of information as to what's going on. This guy didn't even have a fever. He just sneezed. You know, he should have been shipped back to the U.S. and missed out on his vacation.
You don't joke about that at all.
But I'm really kind of surprised regarding the Center for Disease Control. I would just kind of think that the sense of urgency
would put something out there.
Yeah, just the communication or the lack thereof. We do live in the information age. And again, I'm just floored by just the lack of information. When you look at what Dr. Rose was talking about in the 80s with AIDS, it's because there was a lack of information.
Yeah.
So here we are 30 years later, and there's all of these misconceptions out here. And so why aren't we educating the public? I don't get it.
I don't get it either, but my cousin, she's a captain with the Centers for Disease Control. She's in Atlanta, and she's a doctor. So I will... I'm going to check with her.
Yeah.
I'm going to check and see why they haven't been more forthcoming.
Because what's happening now, the media, you know, is reporting
all this.
They've taken charge, and it's so much misconception. Then you have public figures such as your Donald Trump and your Rush Limbaugh who are just feeding fuel to the fire.
Yeah. Feeding the frenzy.
Does anyone know how it got started? I haven't been able
Well, it's been around for many, many years, and it's so bad, though. See, they've had supplies in Sierra Leone, I think, just sitting there on the docks. There is so much corruption in some of those countries. And they'll just be sitting on the docks, nothing to the people they're intended for. That is so unfortunate. It's like I said, a lot is due to corruption. A lot is due to money as far as you got to pay this. Now, when one of the people in charge, their child gets it and so forth. But, you know, with it, you start bleeding out of your face, out of your eyes. I mean, just so much is going on. There's no control. It is, it's a horrible. And I hate to use the word pandemic, but it can become one if we don't act more aggressively. President Obama is trying to get them to act aggressively. There are a lot of nations, too, that are dragging their feet.
Because it can be treated. That's the good news. We've seen it successfully treated in the doctors that were flown back here a couple of months ago. So it can be successfully treated. It's just a matter of, like you said, in the areas hardest hit, the supplies and the treatment measures are not readily available to them because of corruption, because of infrastructure, and so many other reasons. I think in those areas, they say it's combined 3,000, over 3,000 deaths. Now, those are significant. But at the same time, you look at some flu deaths in the United States and can compare to those numbers as well. So it's just a matter of, like you said, really getting a hold of it and containing it, and Tamika, educating the public, like you said. And it's an urgency to do that.
And like you said, it happened during the AIDS, when AIDS was discovered, the epidemic, how they ostracized people and everything. Well, look at the Alabama pastor who admits that he has AIDS, but he slept with church members. He's going to bust all over. No, seriously.
Wow.
It's a pastor, Juan McFarland. He admitted that he had AIDS and had slept with church members without revealing his condition. He should go to jail.
Well, I'm sure he will.
He should go to jail and go to hell. First of all, why are you sleeping with multiple women in the church?
The
pastor.
Right, thank you.
I mean,
unfortunately, we've heard that case far too often.
We've heard that before, but in 2004, he contracted it. In 2008, he was diagnosed with full-blown AIDS.
Wow. And they say, I'm reading here, his biography is still up on the church's website, describing him as a steadfast, immovable, and always abounding in the work of the Lord.
You know, it's funny, he should have a picture up there, but it said bounty, wanted dead or alive.
Exactly.
Because that was wrong. Dead, wrong. I know I'm moving through this, but we don't have as much.
May I add one thing, Ms. Perriman, to that? The ladies aren't talking in the church, you would think. That if he's sleeping with multiple women, somebody would know.
Well, they're
probably
going getting checked.
Okay.
Let's hope so. You know, a lot of people won't, though. I mean, honestly, there's a lot of denial with that, where you know, people won't, and they'll continue to transmit it to other individuals. But it's just an unfortunate situation.
But like you said, that's not a story we haven't heard before about ministers. But sometimes. Well, that's a whole nother story. I used to live upstairs of a minister, a pastor. My family, it was a big two-family flat when I was coming up. And the wife would tell, she'd go to, the woman would call him, Pastor, I need you. And she'd go with him. And one particular night, she went with him, walked in the door, and four of the women of the church were standing around there naked.
Oh, wow, they had a party.
Yeah, they were planning to have a party with him.
Maybe they were reenacting the Adam and Eve days before clothing.
Yeah, he was Adam, and they were for Eve.
Right.
I mean, I hate to, no, but I mean, some people can be put themselves, and you know, and a preacher sometimes is so
charismatic.
Any predator, be it a minister or a child molester, they seek out vulnerability, and we know the churches are. That's where people go who are vulnerable, seeking answers. And so they take advantage of that leadership role. We've seen it, like I said, anyone in position of leadership who could be a predator, you know, youth group leaders,
name
church.
It.
Yes, we can just go on and on. Absolutely. But name it. That's a that's a prime environment.
Even the guy from that movie, that TV show,
yes,
Stephen
Collins,
from Seventh Heaven, yes,
yeah,
he admitted to, oh Lord, who can you trust? All right, Roger Goodell says that the NFL is continuing to work on domestic violence. Needs to be more than the NFL, but they just really messed up last month, and they're trying to redeem themselves. But people are still going to go to games, and
absolutely, they're not going to stop.
And they're not the only ones doing it.
No. But you know, it brought light to the issue again. And how rampant it is in that industry or organization as well. So hopefully the men, the players, and anyone else who's just following these stories will understand that it's not acceptable and how it could lead to you just losing everything.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. I always say today's news is tomorrow's toilet paper.
Yeah.
It can be tomorrow's toilet paper if you don't handle things right. And as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, a few weeks ago, they put a black face on so much of this.
Yeah.
The media has.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The media has. And the thing is that sometimes their families who have this going on in their houses, and this is what their boys or girls see.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And you have to be very, very careful of that, you know, and we can go into that. That's something else. Where it's the responsibility of the parents or the adults. Don't be sitting up there fighting and demeaning and letting your children see that. In fact, you just have to take these people out of the equation.
Mm-hmm. And see that it, again, it's brought light to the fact that this happens on all socioeconomic levels. Again, like you said, the face that is being represented is not just representative of the households that this happens in. It happens at all cultural background, ethnicity, socioeconomic backgrounds, from people in the top 1% to people bottom 1%. It's just a unfortunate existence in our society. And, you know, October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. So it kind of led right into bringing
that.
More awareness.
Have we had
problem.
A call yet about the tickets? Oh, no one has called about the tickets yet. 313-868-4336. But ladies, you still have a chance. Okay, next, I was very affected by that candlelight vigil for that young lady who was in a club, and the guy had asked for her number, and she said no, and he ended up shooting outside the club, and it killed her and injured some of her family members, and her fiance was there also.
So horrible.
What do you do? Well, I remember one day I was walking down the street, and I was going into Comcast. When Comcast was in Detroit, I was just going over there to pay the bill on Puritan or Schoolcraft or something. And I was going in, and the guys were in the car. They said, hey, beautiful, this and that. And I was just ignoring it. And he said, well, I take it back, B. And, you know, he just, you know, they start yelling and harassing you. But what do you do when someone just keeps pursuing?
You have to be cool, and you have to really plan ahead on how you're going to turn the guy down gently. Like, for example, one of the things I may do, I may say, oh, my man is on probation. And, you know, if he doesn't get his act together, then I might have to call you. You just got to kind of put your actress hat on.
Or give him a fake number.
Oh, yeah, but the
I've
thing about the fake
number
the cell
phones now.
Yeah. Is so they have the cell phone. They'll call. He said, put it in my
maybe you take the man's phone number, and you know, you kind of stroke his ego a little bit and tell him again that your man, he's on probation, and if he doesn't get his act together, then you're going to call him. And, you know, just kind of wink at them and just keep it moving. Mm-hmm. But I think it is difficult just to say an outright no, especially if you're looking at the environment that you're in and then the posture of the guy. Yeah. I'm not even going to call him a man. The posture of the male
that,
who's approaching you.
And right. It's unfortunate we have to even go to mm-hmm. those extremes yeah. because we in no way want to blame this victim at all for what happened to her. If she said no, she said no, you mm-hmm. know. But like you said, mm-hmm. understand the mentality of a lot of these people out here have a hard time. It's not the fact that she rejected him. This is a whole psychological issue. When she said no, it just fueled so much anger that he already had brewing in him to react that way. And we have to be aware, we don't know where these people are coming from. We mm-hmm. don't know what their mindset is. So like Tamika said, thinking of a way to say it and say it in a way that doesn't come out as rejection yeah. mm-hmm. to still in some way mm-hmm. stroke their egos.
Yeah. Give them
it's
a little hope.
Not
right, exactly. Yeah, I thought about
yeah,
the whole
it's
thing
not fair that
too.
We have to do that as women, but for mm-hmm. our safety, like you said, especially considering mm-hmm. whatever environment you may yes. be in at that time.
And then people drinking and that yeah. exacerbates yes. the yeah. situation. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's very sad. And then we're going right into Domestic Violence Awareness Month mm-hmm. where it started in 1981, mm-hmm. but a lot of the past few years, there's more attention has been drawn to it. And domestic violence really, in a way, starts when you're young. You could be a teenager and be, you know, abused by a boyfriend mm-hmm. or a girlfriend. Mm-hmm. Women mm-hmm. abuse people too, and it's physical and
emotional.
Yeah,
verbal yeah. abuse as well. Do you all remember the movie The Burning Bed?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The 1980s, and that mm-hmm. brought a lot of attention to domestic violence. Mm-hmm. But just wanted to kind of piggyback on what Ms. Perryman talked about, the verbal abuse. A lot of times it does start there before the guy even hits you. And again, always take it back to the women, that the power that we have as women. And a lot of times I believe that you see signs early on, and it's a matter of, do you want to acknowledge the sign that mm-hmm. you saw? What are you going to do about it? Because I never believe a guy, he just came off and hit you. He showed you step one, step two, or step three that he was about to hit you, and his actions, his posture, the way he looked at you, the way he talked to you, and his overall response.
And they're red flags.
Yeah.
And even if it's not physical abuse, domestic violence can also include, like you said, the verbal abuse. It may never be a hand laid on mm-hmm. you, but even emotional and verbal and economic yeah. abuse can wreak as much havoc yeah. As physical abuse can as well. So people who say, well, he never hit me, or, you know, have mm-hmm. excuses or defenses like that, it still could be just really taking a toll on your self-esteem.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
It can paralyze you. I mean, it could have you self-doubting, which will impact your overall life.
Mm-hmm. And if there's kids in the picture, mm-hmm. that's, you know, as a psychologist, I've treated women who have stayed in relationships for upwards of 25, 30 years that have been physically abusive. Mm-hmm. And again, no mm-hmm. there are no barriers. Nope. You know, these mm-hmm. women are highly educated to ones who may not have much education. Mm-hmm. It doesn't discriminate against anyone. But I always feel bad for the children, because what seems to happen is that, especially if they have multiple children, the children go to one or the other extreme. Children either become abusers themselves who've witnessed this, or they become the abused. And there's very rarely that I find that middle ground. And you mm-hmm. see it, and it just becomes yeah. a vicious cycle that continues to repeat itself through generations mm-hmm. until someone is, you know, has the strength to yes. say, you know, this is where it ends. It ends
absolutely.
Right here.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, tomorrow is yeah. an event that you're participating
yeah.
in. Right?
Yeah. I'll be one of the workshop facilitators at SAFE's annual Health and Wealth Expo, and this is great. It's a free event for the family. Both men and women can come. You can even bring the kids, because there are things to do. They even have this year an area for breastfeeding moms to go in an area where they'll have activities and things for the moms here. But it'll be at Wayne County Community College District, the Northwest Campus on Westsider Drive. So you guys should come out, bring friends, bring your family. There's free lunch, too. It's sponsored by some big entities, MGM, PNC, Comerica, amongst others. So come on out there. And we're going to have health screening, too. So we're going to get Brenda there to get that work on that cough also.
And that's Kaylin Risker's group,
isn't it? Kaylin Risker.
Okay.
Yeah, Kaylin Risker, who is founder of SAFE, and she does a great job. You
phenomenal,
know that.
Phenomenal, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So looking forward to that. Definitely looking forward to it. And I know you, speaking of that, there were signs. You guys want to kind of go over the different
yes.
signs that you're in an abusive relationship? So just your inner thoughts and feelings. Like, if you just feel it doesn't feel right, you know, trust your gut. Like, you know, we know, yeah. Especially those things that you're afraid to tell your friends or you're not going to share with everybody, anybody yes. else, because, you know, it brings shame or embarrassment to you. Sometimes those are the things that you most need to speak about. You yes. know, don't keep those things to yourself. And Cheryl, mm-hmm. you want to?
Oh, you want me to read that?
Well, you can share, yeah, some of those there.
Okay, it says, do you avoid certain topics out of fear of angering your partner? Do you feel that you can't do anything right for your partner?
Walking on eggshells.
Right.
Mm-hmm. People who do
believe
that
you deserve to be hurt or mistreated. Wonder if you're the one who's crazy.
And that's one I see in practice a lot, where you'll have the couple and they'll say, well, I know he did that. And he'll say, no, you did that. You know, it's that mind manipulation, yeah. mm-hmm, yes. putting mm-hmm. the thing back on. And a person starts, you remember that Eddie Murphy yes. stand up where it said, it wasn't me. You know, right, and the right, woman right. starts saying, maybe it wasn't yeah, him right. or what, but you saw it with your own two eyes.
Or more manipulation.
mm-hmm.
That's good, that manipulation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you
yeah.
know, I have on my signature line, don't second guess you. So this whole topic about your inner thoughts and feelings, again, it goes back to when you pay attention, you know something is wrong. You cannot second guess yourself. You don't have to have all of the evidence. You'll know on the inside that something is wrong here.
Yeah. And there is always, you were speaking of this a few minutes ago, that, you know, the red flags yes. or what we call in the mental health field, grooming behaviors. And so okay. what that is, the person starts grooming you before the first, you know, mm-hmm. strike is lands on you. They start grooming you, and grooming could be isolating you from friends and family. That's one of the telltale signs. Mm-hmm. They start criticizing, you know, around you, your friends and family. Those aren't really your friends. You mm-hmm. know, have you doubting, you know, are these people I can reach out to? And or when your friends and family come over, they cause some type of scene that makes your friends and family say, you know, I'm not going over there anymore. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's the ultimate goal. The ultimate yeah. goal is to start isolating you from mm-hmm. people who can be your rescuers, because absolutely. They want you to be all to themselves and dependent on you, dependent on that person mm-hmm. socially, economically, emotionally, yeah. you know, in all those ways. And when you see people start doing those type of behaviors, mm-hmm. and, you know, I think I can remember dating someone before, and it was that situation going on where mm-hmm. you could see when they would get around friends and family, mm-hmm. would be some conflict, and like, where does that come from? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I started mm-hmm. noticing that, and those were big red flags that made mm-hmm. me run and run quickly.
Take off. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, excuse me. This cold. But anyway, these are some of the things that we started dealing with the teen dating violence prevention program I created.
Mm-hmm.
Letting young girls and guys, because girls can be terrible mm-hmm. too.
Mm-hmm.
And they can dog out the guy so much that he's just down on
yeah.
the ground.
And that's mm-hmm. learned behavior. Again, yeah, what yeah. I said, people, it started in the family
yes.
generations
yes.
before.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it just continues to perpetuate itself. Mm-hmm. It continues to do it. And so when the women who belittle, oh my God, I'm working with some women now who are some of the, I tell them they castrate their men, you know, with the way that they speak to them, the way they belittle
yes,
them.
Yes.
But when they give me their history, it was something that they saw growing up. They saw their mom doing it. They saw their grandmother or aunt,
yes.
you know, treating
mm-hmm.
people that way. So you look around you, ladies, you know, look around and see what your children are viewing, because it's a saying you have, you know, Brenda, something
when you
about
raise
your
children, you're raising your grandchildren.
Yeah, when you raise your children,
and
you're raising your grandchildren.
I was mm-hmm. in that situation, and I don't really like to talk about it too much, especially publicly, but what I had to do, and I spoke about this nationally when I was on tour, was I have a son and two daughters. I didn't want my son to grow up thinking that he can abuse a woman. Mm-hmm. I didn't want my daughters to grow up thinking they could be abused.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
That's our responsibility.
Yeah.
And I remember people telling me, oh, but you'll starve and whatever. Well, if I have to eat beans and sleep
yeah.
in a hollow log.
Then
yeah. that's right.
And we're going to talk about this a little more next week. I have a video that I want to put on. Kim Cattrall from Sex and the City. I did an interview with her. It's just a 5-minute interview, and it was about menopause, something that you all have to look forward to.
I don't
want to
have that conversation.
I had that conversation with my daughter yesterday, my
did
oldest
you?
Daughter. She said, I don't know. Well, there's such a thing as perimenopausal.
It is. And Heather's about that age that I am. So we're starting to see some changes going on.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Well, if we could put on that interview.
I'm good. This is a topic very close to my heart.
close to all of
our
hearts.
Tell us a little bit about your experience with menopause.
Well, my first experience, Brenda, with menopause was actually on a film set. We were shooting a scene from Sex and the City, and Samantha was having her first hot flash. And so the first thing I did, you know, as a very dedicated actress that I am, I called my health provider, and we had a conversation of really what a woman could expect on her first hot flash. And then about 2 years later, it was actually happening to me, and I really do believe that I underplayed it. It was like being put into a pot of boiling water instantly. I could see my face getting redder and redder, and I thought, wow, this is overwhelming. I'm going to need some help with this. Of course, I went to my girlfriends, who are always there for me, but it was actually my health provider that put me on a road to really dealing and tuning into my menopause.
Right. So what is tune into menopause?
Well, it's really about, Patsy, isn't it? It's about tuning into what is going on for you in your body, the change that is occurring, which is medically absolutely natural, isn't it?
Yes, and tuneintomenopause.com really gives women some important information. It talks about some of the symptoms that they're going through at that time, particularly, as Kim described, the hot flashes, which... I can also speak personally. You're not ready for it when it's happening. It's happening. You're like, oh, my goodness. And to let them know if they're having these hot flashes, that most women do have them. 80% of women have hot flashes when they're going through the menopause. And half the time, they can be moderate to severe. But also, there's information on there about the declining bone density that can occur at this time. As you're going through a menopause, estrogen levels go down. The bones can start to thin. That can lead to osteoporosis. So it's very important that women take ownership and really learn about the things that are going on at this critical stage of their life so that they'll have, you know, be better prepared on how to manage these problems.
Yeah, I remember when I was going through it, and I used to teach, and I'd have the windows open in the class. The kids would be all cold. And
it was December in Detroit.
Anyway, how do you talk to your health provider, Dr. Shulak? What suggestions do you have on how to talk to your health?
Really good question. First of all, they need to write down what's going on, the questions that they have, what they're experiencing, because they're going to come in and forget, and they'll go, I wish I would have talked about that. Write down what you're experiencing, the severity of it, and also walk in as an informed patient. Go to reliable websites like tuneintomenopause.com or healthcare institutions or cdc.gov or the NIH. Go armed with important information to let your provider know that you're taking ownership. And because one size does not fit all. What your healthcare provider recommends to you may be different than what they recommended to your friend or your neighbor.
Right.
So,
or your sister.
Or your sister. So it's this is a time that's very important, and it's individual.
Well, Dr. Shulak, what can women do to help manage the symptoms of menopause?
There are so many things that they can do. First of all, lifestyle. We need to be taking care of ourselves. We need to take ownership of our health. I mean, just like Kim does. You know, what are we eating? Exercising. Those things can really, really help manage some of these symptoms, looking at a lot of lifestyle issues. And then there are, medications that are available that are FDA approved, that can also help. So there's lifestyle issues, there's, all sorts of products that are available, but one size does not fit all. This is very individual.
Right, and Kim, just like you had to work through it, women have to work through it. We work, we do a lot of things. So Dr. Shulak or Kim, where can we get more information about it?
Well, I think think at the website, tuneintomenopause.com, is a really wonderful place to start. I wish that it had existed when I went into menopause, you know, about 7-8 years ago. One of my girlfriends said, what is it called again? I said, it's tuneintomenopause.com. She says, where were you 6 years ago? So I think
absolutely.
We're...
Absolutely. We need this.
Yes.
We thank you all both, and I want you to have a wonderful day. And Kim, my daughter, says hi because, you know, she still watches the reruns every day. I said, how can you do it? But wonderful show, and you were wonderful.
Thank you
Dr.
so much.
Shulak,
thanks,
too.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Because we still have to work through it. When you it happens, you still have to work through it. But you ladies can sit down and talk to me anytime you want. But that's part of a bigger conversation.
It is. Yeah.
So
it's
people
huge.
Understand what's happening mm-hmm. to them at that particular time.
Absolutely.
And, because my mother didn't tell me that much about it, you know.
Well, you know, that generation didn't talk about it. You just went, you know, I remember going over my mom's house when, look, in hindsight, she must have been going through it at that time. And we'd be like, it's so dark in here. We turn on light, turn off that light. It's so hot, it's so hot in here. And be like, what is wrong with this woman? Like, she has lost her mind. Like, it is not hot.
Dark and cool.
Hilarious.
Wow, that was amazing. That was amazing. Well, ladies, it's time to. I'm going to do Carol Burnett's theme, but I'm not going to sing
ear.
It.
Just pull your
good
ear.
We had this time together. Oh, now it's time to say goodbye. Everybody, thanks for joining us. We just had so much to talk about today and couldn't go into depth as much. And somebody called and got those tickets.
Yay.
Check out Addicted and let me know what you think. I'll see you next week. We'll see you next week.
Bye-bye.